than just business news, we're news for business people. Welcome to Bloomberg Quint Live, and you're watching Trendspotting. I'm Navneet Saluja D'Souza.
Hi, I'm Agam Akhil, and in the next 30 minutes, we deep dive into specific trends in the markets to draw out key takeaways and its implications for investors. But first, the headlines. Markets maintain early weakness on expiry day, and the Nifty trades near the day's low, below the mark of 10,300. And after yo-yoing between gains and losses, Bitcoin is finally back above the mark of $10,000 a Bitcoin. And McLeod Russell recovers losses and gains nearly 10% after the promoter clarifies on the sales of shares. And Reliance Communications had reached out to its Indian lenders in a bid to stop the China Development Bank from filing an insolvency plea, but to no avail. That's a Bloomberg exclusive.
All right, let's first take a look as to what's happening in the markets today. The final day of the November series, and clearly markets started off on a very weak note owing to the weak cues coming in from the Asian markets. You had all the Asian markets in the morning which were trading in the red. Nifty right now around those levels of 10,281. The low for the day stands at about 10,276. And remember, the first support is somewhere around the 10,270 mark. And if that gets breached, the next mark to be watched out on the downside will be about 10,250. Sensex also down 270 points, and weakness is there for the financials today. So the Bank Nifty is down almost close to 1%, and you've also got the PSU banking space, which is contributing to the majority of the losses that one is seeing. There you go, Bank Nifty almost at day's low. The Nifty PSU banking index is down as much as 1%. Majority of your sectoral indices are trading in the red, just barring Nifty Realty, and the PSU bank is your top sectoral loser there, followed by some losses is also seen for the Nifty FMCG index. Let's also quickly just pull up the advanced decline ratio and see how the broader markets are also faring, which have been in the red. So clearly, the market breadth today is in favor of the declines, as it is being indicated on the NSE stats graph there on your screen. Just pull up the Nifty contributors chart, and that will tell you which are the stocks which are dragging the index lower. And clearly, the list today is being dominated by the financials. Reliance, one of the heavyweights, is dragging the index lower by 13 points. But besides that, look at that. HDFC, HDFC Bank, as well as ICICI Bank, all these stocks have been trading in the red. On the gaining side, some relief seen from stocks like Infi, Bosch up for the second straight day. India Bulls Housing, Bajaj Auto are the ones which are trading in the green. Well, as we mentioned, the broader markets two are in the red, Agam, but any specific stocks which are standing out?
Sure, Navneet, I'm going to start off with the losers, and we have SREI Infrastructure, which has declined by as much as 3%, and we have Jacob, followed by Balrampur Chini and Indoco Remedies, along with Marksans Pharma, losing out between 2.5% to 3%. Well, while we do have more losers as against those stocks which are advancing, you know, in terms of momentum, it is with the gainer. So McLeod Russell is up as much as nearly 11.5%, and Ratan India Power is also gaining 7.7%. Religare Enterprises, continuing to build on gains that we've seen in the previous couple of days, is also up 6.2%, followed by Soba and Techno Electric. All these stocks are gaining up as much as nearly 4.5% to 5%. So while we have seen more losers as against gainers in today's day of trade, the momentum still is with those which are advancing.
All right, so that's about the markets. But on Trendspotting today, we decode the buzz in gas distribution companies with Dinesh Rohira of finance.com. We also analyze the trends in the dairy space with Naval Sharma of Kwality. And we get you a pulse on the dealing rooms ahead of the November auto sales to be reported tomorrow. All right then, moving on to our first trend of the day. Kwality is the stock in focus after its revenues from the B2C segment has seen a substantial improvement in the quarters gone by. But remember, the stock has also been under pressure on YTD basis. It's been down almost 16 to 17%. Let's check what's the business outlook going ahead. We are joined on the show, and to discuss the business trends, Mr. Naval Sharma, who is the president and head of business transformation at the company. Mr. Sharma, good morning to you, and thanks thanks a lot. Appreciate you joining us today on Bloomberg Quint. Well, first up, I just wanted to check the trends with regard to your procurement. How much of your procurement is currently done through traders? If you could tell us what's the ratio. And also, you had lined up a CapEx. What's the trend which you're seeing in terms of procurement there? What's the kind of run rate? And also, if you could indicate to us the procurement prices, have they increased?
You see, so far as the procurement part is concerned, the direct sourcing channel today contributes around 26% of the overall sourcing. And this we intend to take it to around 50% over the next 2 to 3 years' time. Now, this is absolutely in sync with our overall value-added product strategy that has been lined up. So this is on the sourcing front. And second, you talked about the CapEx part. Now, so far as the CapEx part is concerned, there is an there is an overall planned outlay of around 520 crores broken into two buckets. So there is a procurement infrastructure bucket where the plan is to the tune of 120 crores. And then there is plant and infrastructure upgrade which needs around 400 crores. And out of these 520 crores, around 437 crore has already been executed. And balance 83 crores will be done over the next 12 to 15 months time. And this gives us an overall capacity of around 9 lakh liters per day in terms of the value-added products, which at its full potential by 2020 will be able to generate an overall revenue of around 1,800 to 2,000 crores.
Okay, Mr. Sharma, I wanted to get an idea of milk prices and procurement, which I understand because of seasonality of the business has fallen from what we used to see in around the months of summer. But there has also been talk about some of the governments trying to bring in a minimum support price. I wanted to understand what you're hearing with respect to minimum support price. What are the existing prices right now? And should we see a factor come in for players like yourself when it comes to MSP? What could it mean for the company?
You see, so far as the procurement prices are concerned, so currently it is hovering anywhere between 34 to 39 rupees a liter. And as we estimate over the next couple of months' time, we look for a softening to the tune of around 5%. And beyond that, the situation will reveal maybe towards February or so. So that's the outlook on the procurement prices. So so far as MSP part is concerned, so currently there are no data points with respect to that. But in any case, whenever there is a development, we can talk about that. So otherwise, there is no discussion as of now, and there is no anticipation that there will be something like MSP or so in this particular space.
Okay.
Could you tell us what's the mix in terms of revenues from liquid and S&P as of now?
You see, so far as the product mix is concerned, so currently the mix is to the tune of 60-40. 60% is B2B and 40% is B2C. And this will transform into 70% of the revenues coming from B2C by 2020. So that's the target which we are chasing. And this will help us in terms of improving our overall margin profile to around 9 to 9.5%.
I wanted to know what's
now, from
the
where this confidence comes, if you...
I wanted to know what's the revenue mix coming in from the skim milk powder and from liquid. What's the ratio there?
Yeah, you see, so far as the mix is concerned, as I talk about the B2C parts, which contributes 40%, around 24% comes from pouch milk, and 6% is curd, 7% is ghee, around 2% is charge, and balance 1 to 2% is the other. So that's the mix.
Okay, so Mr. Sharma, you were talking about...
And SMBs, others put together is to the tune of around 7%.
Right. So, Mr. Sharma, you were talking about the strength and the confidence that you would transform your business and about eventually you would eventually have about 70% of your business coming from B2C. And you were also telling us the factors that you feel which would make you confident of reaching that particular number. Can you tell us about those factors?
See, it's all about, so internally what we have defined is, we have defined internally what we call as 4, 4 and 24 strategy. And the core of this is how basically this B2C is executed on the ground. So what is the first four? We have got four core strategies, which is the branding strategy, which aims to build a very differentiated brand in the space. Second is the product strategy, where we are re-engineering the product portfolio to deliver an improved bottom line to the tune of 9 to 9.5% by 2020. Third part is sales and distribution strategy, which aims to take our current outlet numbers from 50,000 numbers to around 115,000 numbers by 2020. And fourth part is the procurement strategy, which is the backbone of dairy industry. And here we intend to take our direct sourcing contribution from 26% to around 50%. And for this, we have also done a path-breaking and first-of-its-kind deal with Bank of Baroda, which we discussed last time. So these are the four core strategies. And these are further supported by four enablers, what we call as Kwality. We are talking about IT, we are talking about people. And the fourth part and the most important pillar is the corporate governance framework. And these eight strategies and enablers are further supported by 24 distinct programs within the organization. And as a result of this is what we are actually delivering these hardcore numbers on the ground.
Okay, Mr. Sharma, there's one more question. Now, I understand that eventually, as you shift towards B2C, you will see an improvement in margins and, of course, better working capital conditions as well. But in the near term, there are certain reports that suggest that while you are moving into this transition, there could be a little bit of pressure on your margins. Is that true, or will you at least be able to sustain these margins in the near term as you adapt to your new strategy?
Yeah, so let me again talk about numbers, which will give you the confidence. As we are delivering this B2C strategy on the ground, there has been a consistent improvement of margin profile. If I just take you 2 years back, in FY16, the EBITDA margin was at 6%, moved to 6.7% in FY17. Q1, it moved to 6.9%. Q2, it moved to 7.1%. So there has been a consistent delivery and improvement on the EBITDA margin. So it will continue over the next 3 to 4 years' time, in line with the overall strategic game plan, and we don't think any reason as to why it should dip.
Mr. Sharma, I was just looking at the cash conversion cycle of your business. It's almost 92 days. Now, if I compare that with your peers from the likes of Heritage, theirs is 10 days, Hudson is 15 days. Could you tell us why there is such a big difference between your cash conversion cycle and your peers?
Yeah, so that's a very good question. See, to compare the numbers, one has to see the business model. Now, cash conversion cycle is an outcome of what kind of product mix you are having with respect to B2B and B2C. On one side, there are organizations with 90% B2C, whereas our ratio is 60-40 at this point of time. Now, this cash conversion cycle used to be 100 days plus a couple of years back, which has already reduced to 92 to 93 days. Now, as we'll be hitting 70-30 ratio in favor of B2C, the overall cash conversion cycle will be touching somewhere between 55 to 60 days. So that's how the progression will happen. Now, as to why
down
it is different from the peer group, it
days?
Is only because of the product mix that one is carrying.
By when do you anticipate that it will
go down to... 55 to 60 days is what we'll be hitting by 2020.
By 2020, all right. And if you could also just give us some sense with regard to the working capital days right now, how has that changed over the last 1 year, and what kind of projection do you have for the next financial year?
You see, we generally avoid basically making short-term guidance because organization is evolving and a lot of fronts are open right now. So that's the reason we have talking about the vision for 2020. And then we support this vision with respect to the past data points. So as I mentioned, in terms of number of days, data days, which used to be, let's say, 100 plus, has already been reduced to around 75 days. Again, it is actually nothing but the outcome of this strategy being implemented on the ground. And this will continue to become better and better as the mix is changing. So without commenting on a short-term horizon, long-term numbers I have shared with you, which I have supported with the last couple of years as to how these numbers are improving. And this is what gives us the confidence that as to why there'll be consistent delivery on the numbers that we are talking about.
Okay, Mr. Sharma, just a final question on my side that is to do with your finance costs, which of course have gone up on a year-to-date basis. That's because you have taken up debt in terms of implementing your strategy. But can you give us some amount of timelines in which you can see, an eventual, gradual, reduction in your debt levels, which will also mean an improvement in your bottom line?
Yeah, so there are multiple strategies in terms of managing the cost of debt. For example, first focus, as we said, as we are changing the product mix, it is going to reduce the overall cash conversion cycle. So that is the one lever that we are talking about. And second thing we are talking about, capital structure optimization, which will help us eliminating some of the high cost debt. And then we are also talking about, recently there has been an increase in the rating of the organization also, which will help us negotiating better rates with the from the institutions. And fourth part, as these VAP strategy is being executed on the ground, this will generate a lot of internal cash flows. So on an overall basis, we are confident that within 3 to 4 years' time, we will develop the capability of becoming debt-free. But we would like to retain debt to ensure and to leverage the benefit of debt to optimize the overall cost of capital. So this is what is our take in terms of how we intend to manage the cost of debt over the next 3 to 4 years' time.
Okay, before we let you go, I just have a question. In the month of September, you had clarified that the pledge shares of the promoters were not being sold. I just want to check, overall, currently, 57% of the promoter holding, which stands somewhere about 63 to 64, is pledged. By when can we see the promoters releasing their pledge?
See, as we mentioned, not even a single share has been sold, so far as the promoter part is concerned, right? So we are in a process of discussion where some of the fixed assets will get released, and that's how the mortgage which is there with respect to shares will automatically get released over the next 3 to 4 months' time. But not even a single share has been sold so far. So let me re-emphasize on that.
Okay, Mr. Sharma, that's all that we have for you today. Thank you so much for joining us and giving us a perspective on Kwality and as well as the outlook on the company going ahead. But we'll move on and address the second trend of the day, and that is that vehicles are shifting to cleaner sources of energy, and conventional fuel like petrol and diesel may eventually see a drop in demand. But what stands to gain, at least in India, is the city natural gas distribution companies, who have been increasing their presence across Tier 1 and Tier 2 cities. And while retail prices have been rising over the past few quarters, it is still much cheaper than diesel prices, which only works to be an advantage. And to joining us to discuss more of the same is Dinesh Rohira of Finance.com, and of course our very own Swamit Sarkar, also to give us an outlook as well as perhaps joining the discussion with respect to the city gas distribution companies. Dinesh, thank you for joining us. Good morning to you. Let me start off with the fact that we are looking at less and less dependence on conventional fuel. What does that mean for your city gas distribution companies?
Yeah, I guess, you know, in terms of the pollution as well as the legislation and some mandates that has been given to taxi aggregators also in terms of switching to CNG, there's going to be a significant shift from traditional forms of fuels to gas-based vehicles. So from that context, there are these city gas distribution players as well as some of the traditional players as well who are going to gain significantly in terms of gas consumption over the next few years. We do expect anywhere in the range of 20 to 25% CAGR growth over the next 3 to 5 years horizon for any of these gas players that are prevalent in the marketplace.
Other than these two reasons, that is the government push for cleaner fuel and state governments mandating the use of CNG, what are the other possible reasons? Like I have listed out few reasons, I'll just tell them, and then you can add in whether you think there are more possible reasons for this. The first what I could think is increase in car costs because of BS6 coming in. Second is a possible inclusion of natural gas under GST, which would bring down the prices of retail gas prices. Also, there is a possibility that other states might mandate the use of CNG for public transport because of rising pollution. What are the other reasons that you think? And do you think these reasons could actually boost the demand for natural gas?
Yeah, it would certainly. And the last one as well as the second last one, the inclusion in GST as well as other states mandating is a significant one. We would see that growing in the coming two odd years. Apart from this, we are also seeing these city gas distribution companies spreading up into semi-urban and rural segments as well. So they are spreading up their network in these areas as well. Specifically, if I talk about Mahanagar Gas, there's a significant expectation on uptick in their volumes once the Raigad infra push that is going on is going to get operational in terms of the revenues coming in. So they are expecting those jumps in their revenues from the next fiscal onwards. Likewise, they have plans in getting up into other semi-urban and rural segments as well.
What is the kind of volume growth that you're expecting from Mahanagar Gas?
So I do expect anywhere in the range of 25% over the next 3 to 5 years horizon from both IGL as well as Mahanagar Gas.
And what is your outlook on Gujarat Gas Limited?
I guess I would rate them in that order, IGL, MGL and Gujarat Gas in terms of the performance, though IGL has performed quite well. But there's still some significant amount of steam left. MGL follows later, and Gujarat Gas, you know, we may see some amount of uptick post these elections as well.
Okay, and what is your view on the fact that CNG and PNG are both cheaper when compared to the conventional fuels like petrol, diesel, and when you see PNG, it is even cheaper to subsidized LPG.
Correct.
So yeah, what is your view on that, and what is the kind of growth that you're expecting from the PNG segment of the city gas distribution companies?
So a large part of the consumption is moving towards these gas-based consumptions, right? And PNG is going to take a lead in the coming future, along with CNG. LPG is going to take a backseat. So from that context, all these players are going to gain significantly because they have invested significantly in these areas.
And what is your view about the petcoke ban that has come in?
I think, you know, that will have its impact, but not too significant enough.
So the petcoke ban wouldn't boost the volumes of the city gas distribution.
Yeah, because when we look at the consumption that we have, as well as the ban that has come in, right from that context, it will have a small dent, but not a significant one.
And when it comes to expansion plans of these city gas distribution companies, do you think IGL will benefit the most, because I guess it has more expansion plans when compared to MGL and Gujarat Gas?
I agree with you. Yeah, I agree with you. So IGL has been a sector leader from a significant period of time. So IGL has better expansion plans compared to the other players. But I would say that IGL has, from a stock price standpoint, it has already appreciated this year by about 50%. MGL has a catch-up to play. Over the medium term, I would rate MGL to be better placed. But over the short term. But over a medium term, IGL would certainly be the leader compared to the other players.
Okay, so Dinesh, if I'm getting this right, in the near term, how would you place both these players that you're talking about right now in terms of investment, and how would you then compare it to, say, for someone who has a horizon of around, say, 3 to 4 years from here on?
So over the next 1 year, I would place an MGL with, let's say, a target price of about 1,300 rupees. So we do see about close to 30% upside. IGL, we look at something around 390, so about 20% upside from here. But over 3 to 5 year horizon, I would expect IGL to provide a 25 to 30% CAGR growth over the next 3+ years, whereas MGL would be anywhere in the range of 20 to 25%.
Okay, Dinesh, that's all we have for you. Thank you very much for joining us and giving us your perspective on City Gas Distribution Companies Summit. Also, thank you for joining us for this discussion. But yes, that's what we have. City Gas Distribution Companies looking good.
Navi. Well, let's move to autos then. The automakers may post double-digit sales growth in the month of November. Not because sales have suddenly shot up, but it's exactly a year ago that the government's cash ban dented vehicle sales. Yash Upadhyay, who spoke to 35 dealers from across the country, joins us now with all the details. Yash, so what are the dealers suggesting this time around?
Well, thanks for that, Navneet. And as you rightly said, the November sales would look very good as compared to last year. And this has mainly got to do with the fact that Prime Minister Narendra Modi announced. the demonetization in the first week of November of 2016, and that had a severe impact on auto sales. So on a month-on-month basis, however, November has been slower as compared to October. So let's take a look at some of the numbers. We'll get them on the screen. Yeah, so Maruti Suzuki sales are estimated to go up by about 12%, Tata Motors 17%, and Mahindra & Mahindra, this one is an important name because Mahindra & Mahindra sales fell as much as 22% in November of 2016 because of the demonetization, and because of that low base, we are expecting anywhere around 38.5% growth, maybe a little bit lower. So a small disclaimer, this is just a dealer survey, so it may not pan out exactly as the way. So what's working for them? Well, for Maruti Suzuki, the Baleno line and Brezza continue to do very well. The Brezza continues to hold a waiting period of anywhere between 16 to 18 weeks, while Baleno has anywhere between 10 weeks. Also, the Desire and the S-Cross refresh is doing very well for the company, and the company manages to sell one out of every two cars sold. So good news there for Maruti. Tata Motors, again, the newly launched Nexon is being received very well among the masses, and the compact sedan Tigor and Tiago are doing very well for them as well. Mahindra & Mahindra, Bolero and the Scorpio both are doing very well in the north and western regions, along with XUV doing very well for them as well. So that's that in terms of four-wheelers. But since we are talking about trend spotting, a trend that I've seen and a lot of dealers have been telling me is that a lot of customers tend to, you know, defer their purchase for a new car towards the end of the year, and this has mainly got to do with the registration aspect. So they do tend to get their cars registered in the new year so as to save on the depreciation cost and enhance their resale value. So do watch out for that. And in the two-wheeler space, obviously Hero MotoCorp has a huge share in the rural segment. We expect their sales to go up by 25%. Bajaj Auto, another name which had seen its sales go down significantly in November of 2016, could see a 36% growth. TVS Motors, with their Jupiter line of scooters and another trend out there, but we'll talk about it later, could see its sales go up by 40%. Royal Enfield, an outlier, it saw its sales grow despite of demonetization, and again we can see a 20% growth there. In two-wheelers especially, the scooter segment is likely to do much better than the bikes, and that is the reason why we see such big moves in TVS and Hero, with TVS's Jupiter line of scooters which occupy the second spot ahead of Hero MotoCorp's Maestro and the other names. What's selling for them really well? Like I said, for Hero, it is the Maestro, Pleasure and Duet, which are the scooters, and also the entry-level bikes like the Splendor, Passion and the Glamour 125cc. So that is doing very well for them. For Royal Enfield, obviously the Bullet 350 is the top seller as far as Royal Enfield goes. For Bajaj Auto, obviously is the Pulsar NS, and in the entry-level, it's the Platina, which does very well for them. And for TVS Motors, like I said, it is their Jupiter line of scooters and the Apache RTR in the top line.
Yash, which one do you like the most?
Well, I like the Royal Enfield.
Of course, as would anyone.
Do you own one or you plan to buy?
Let's just say I'm more of a car person, so maybe sooner or later.
All right, Yash, all the best for that. And thanks for bringing in all those details. So watch out for the November auto sales number, which start trickling in from tomorrow. Remember, the increase that you see will be coming on account of the low base, because the last year in the month of November, demonetization was announced. Before we wrap the show, just going to highlight the tea stocks here. They've inched higher once again. So pull up any tea company from the likes of Jayashree Tree, McLeod, Goodrick. Look at the gains there. McLeod Russell is now up also as much as 11%. You've also got companies like Ross Hill India, that's up 5%. Harrison Malayalam is up almost 13%. So clearly, it looks like the cycle for these tea companies has actually changed, because we've been interacting with a lot of managements and they've indicated that the prices have gone up by almost 15 to 20 rupees per kg.
Right, absolutely, and we have seen that surge. It's behind that gain as far as tea stocks are concerned. But we've reached to the end of the show, and that is a wrap on this edition of Trend Spotting. And don't go anywhere. Up next is Hot Money. Stay tuned in the Bloomberg.